So in this short video, I will try to explain the proof of Lagrange's equation of motion. So this is the topic of this short video, Lagrange equation of motion. Please excuse me for any grammatical mistakes. Okay, so this is the topic, Lagrange equation of motion. So why to study this topic? Well, we already know Newton's equation of motion. We are all familiar already with Newton's equation of motion, which is a very old one. And I can write the Newton equation of motion for you now. You will know this is, it can be written this way, the force equals to the mass multiplied by acceleration. Please don't forget that this is the vector. It's a vector equation on both sides. The force is a vector and the acceleration is a vector. And it's also written for a single part. Single part. And it's written in terms of the acceleration. Acceleration. I'm sorry for my bad English. These mistakes are also bad handwriting. Let us try to use a more decent way. So it is written in terms of the acceleration. And in fact, acceleration is not straightforward in our minds. We are straightforward to speak about velocity. Yes, we like velocity, and everybody, even those who did not go to the college, know what's velocity, and also everybody knows what is position. But unfortunately, this equation, the equation of Newton, is not written in terms of these two quantities, the velocity and the position. It's written in terms of vector, it's a force, and indeed, the concept of the force itself is not clear. As we have mentioned in other videos, or as I will illustrate later, and the concept of the acceleration itself is not clear. As it is clear for the concept of the velocity, anybody driving the car knows what's the velocity, and everybody knows what is position. So we would like to write new equation in terms of the velocity and the position, and not just the position as we will see later. Okay? And we will not include even the force. This is Lagrange's equation of motion. Lagrange's equation of motion is written in terms of the following. Lagrange's equation of motion is written in terms of the following. Is written in terms of velocity and energy and something called degrees of freedom. And I think we have already discussed the concepts of degrees of freedom in another lecture. Okay? So that's what we want to do. We would like to get rid of this or get something instead of this one. A new equation in terms of the velocity and energy and degrees of freedom. And guess what? This is a vector equation, right? The new equation will be in terms of scalars only. And indeed, our brains or we like scalars more than we like vectors, of course. So we have enough motivation to start finding this new equation. So how to go through the proof or how to find this equation? That's what we are going to see now. So let us find a new slide. Let's begin also, but instead of writing force equal mass multiplied by acceleration, I would like to remind you, it's not just the force, it is the summation of the force, or it is the result of it. Which is a common mistake, in fact, to forget that this is the summation of all forces, okay? So I don't like to use this summation now, because we will use many summations later. So I just write the resultant as R. Instead of writing sigma f, I will write r. And you know that r is the resultant equal to the mass multiplied by acceleration. That's the first. The second, as I already mentioned, this equation is written for a single particle. In some problems, you will have more than one particle in your system. So, still, you write a single equation for every single particle. So, you write it in this way, use the index I equal mi multiply ai, where I stands for the subscript for a particle I. Let us say that we have particles. How many particles? We have the particles equal to n particles, total n particles. So this index runs from 1 to n. So in fact you have n vectorial equations. So let's use starting points. So what are we going to do now? We will do something called the Lambert's principle, or we use something that's called the Lambert principles. I hope that I'm not writing any mistakes, but in fact the problem is that they are French, so I don't know, but it is called the Lambert principle. So what does Lambert say? The Lambert principle says, well, you get R minus M A. And please don't forget that you will have many particles, so you have Ri minus MriAi. Now you just got the left hand side to the right hand, from the right to the left. So it should be equal to zero. Okay, it's a zero vector by the way. But Lambert like goes one more step, he writes that you will get the dot product of this equation with something called the virtual displacement. And the concept of virtual displacement was already introduced in another video, so I will not repeat it now, just to avoid distraction. Okay, so now when you make this dot product, that's very important. Now you, as I already mentioned, when this dot product changes this equation from a vector equation to a scalar equation. That's all. Okay, so let's see how to advance, because I already promised that we will have an equation terms of the velocities and energies and degrees of freedom. Indeed, we are still far here in this stage. We are still far from what I have already mentioned. So how to go further? Just let us revise how to write the virtual displacement. The virtual displacement for a particle I can be written as partial Ri by partial Q1, variation Q1, plus partial Ri by partial Q2 multiplied by another variation of virtual or whatever of delta Q2. Okay, in fact Q, let us say J, is degree of freedom, is one of the degrees of freedom of the system. Degree of freedom of the system. And the concept of degrees of freedom was discussed somewhere else. So in fact delta Ri can be written in a more compact summation in this row, in this, let us say summation from J equal to 1, and I wrote like n capital, it will be n capital, where n is the total number of degrees of freedom. Total number of degrees of freedom. I will write DOF, instead of writing the full degrees of freedom, partial Ri by partial Qj, delta Qj. Now we have many indices, I and J and summations. Things likely did become more complicated, but if you just concentrate for a few minutes, it will be just very clear. So that's the first. You need to rewrite the virtual displacements in this way. That's the first. The second, now I need to introduce a very, very important law or corollary or relation. Or just you can mention, you can call it whatever you like. It's called the dot, and I write in big letter, dot cancellation. This rule is very important because it allows for a very important result. So what is the dot cancellation? That's what I'm going to explain in the next few minutes. The dot cancellation is very important. Now we have been distracted a little because we should have worked directly with this equation, but we are going in some strange direction. The dot cancellation, unfortunately, we have to go through this way. So what's the dot cancellation? The dot cancellation, I will write the results directly. It tells you that partial Ri by partial Qj is equal to partial Ri dot by partial Qj dot. So what is this dot? I would like to, this is a shorthand notation or a simplified notation for the total time derivative for either the position vector or the degree of freedom. Qj dot is equal to dqj, is not a g, this is a q, by dt. So this growth cancellation, but how does it come from? Please remember that this we call it growth cancellation because it seems like the rods are cancelled from both the from the denominator and the from the numerator and the numerator. So we just call it the growth cancellation. So this the so please before just going through more. From your books, I would like to tell you, or I would like to state a very important matter, that this equation is only valid for the case of Horner limit constraints. Now, I know that things are getting more and more like weird. Yes, Horner limit constraints. So, what are Horner limit constraints? The conditions for Horner limit constraints is that I write it in red. We already mentioned it before, but for a whole other constraint, you can write that the position vector Ri can be written in terms of what? The degrees of freedom Q1, Q2, Qn, and the time. And now you can say, fine, this is for any constraint, a whole other no. I will give you just as a reminder or an example for what's the harmonic constraint. For example, if Ri was written like Ri of Q1, Q2, and the Q2 dot on time, so this is a non-harmonic constraint. Non-holonomic constraints. Indeed, many situations we have holonomic constraints, but still non-holonomic constraints are there, and they can be even, to say they are more practical. That's why analytical mechanics is not used in everyday engineering applications, for example, because they are, but however, they are very important in theoretical physics. So for this non-holonomic constraint, you cannot use the dot cancellation. Okay. So let us start to prove the dot cancellation. Okay, the dot cancellation is written in this way. Let us begin and write, we want to get partial of I by partial Qj. We want to put this one. Whether or not it is equal to partial Ri dot by partial Qj. So where to start? The start is from Ri itself. As we already mentioned, Ri is a function of Q1, Q2, dot, and you know what I mean, until Qn and T. So let us get Ri dot itself. It's a very good exercise to do this. Ri dot, somebody will say, fine, it is partial Ri by partial T. Because it's time derivative, and this is incorrect. You need to revise your calculus because this is not a partial derivative, it's a total time derivative. So it is dRi by dt. And please get, pay some attention to the difference between the partial derivative and the total derivative. Okay? Some books use the capital D, but I think it's not so necessary. So, what's different now? You need to write it partial Ri by partial Q1 multiply dQ1 by dt plus, it's not easy to write in this way, however, you need to write more terms just to understand what's going on. So I write it here one more time and you understand what I mean. Ri dot I is equal to partial Ri by partial Q1. And instead of this one, I write Q1 dot, and I have already justified what's the meaning of Q1 dot. And partial Ri by partial Q2, Q2 dot, plus, what goes next, partial Ri by partial T. Now we have what? Now what we have before? We have something like the right hand side. But it's what we need to get the partial derivative of this partial r I dot by partial q dot j. And it's possible to answer yes. It's possible to do it. This is what we can tell you. Yes, let us get, for example, partial r dot by partial q one dot. And you get what I mean, what I want to say. So indeed, the question is, do we have any q one dots here? This is a q dot 2. It's independent. This q 2 dot, one important like about degrees of freedom is that degrees of freedom are independent from each other. So q2 is independent from q1, so indeed q2 dot is independent from q1 dot. So when you, this is one, when you write partial derivative of this q1 dot, this term, q dot is like a constant. So what about partial ri by partial q2 and partial ri by partial t? When I say partial, this term, does it have any dependence on q1 dot? The answer is no, it does not have any dependence. Why? Because we have already mentioned that we are just dealing with holonomic constraints, and in holonomic constraints the position is just a function of the degrees of freedom. In reality, it doesn't include any dependence on the time variation of the degrees of freedom. So this one also acts like a constant, and also this one acts like a constant, and this one. So all these terms cancel, and we are just left with what? We are just left with partial ri by partial q1. And it seems that we already got what we are looking for. Object say you have just proved this for one. No, but it goes, you can try the same with two and with three or whatever. There is nothing special about the index one. So we have just proved now the dot cancellation, and fortunately we can refer now to our main goal, which is to work further about this equation. Okay, so let us work further now. The equation which we have stopped working is Ri minus Mi Ar dot delta Ri is equal to zero. Now we will do something very interesting. As we have already mentioned, we have n particles in our system, so for each n part you have this, by the way, this is a scalar equation, so there is no problem, it's equal to zero, there is no problem in adding all these n equations for n zeros and equating the result also to zero, of course. Fine. So let us now put this aside, and let us deal, for example, with this term. Indeed, you know, or without going further, that we have now two terms, two basic terms. The first one is Ri dot delta R small r, and you can equate it to the summation of Mr Ar dot delta Ri. So let us begin with the left hand side. So what about the left-hand side? Okay, we will rewrite it in this way. This is the summation. The resultant acting on particle I multiply the virtual displacement. If you remember, we have rewritten the virtual displacement in this compact form. It's partial Ri by partial Qj delta Qj with j runs from 1 to n, where n is the total number of degrees of freedom found in your system. So how to proceed now? Now you have a double summation. This is a double summation over two dummy indices, which I and j. In fact, you can rewrite your equation in this way. It's a double summation, and of course people who like mathematics will feel a little bit happy now for what's being written. With j and n, because now it's like more beautiful now. It's more beautiful now, and you get the summation on the left, and everything now is like looks like more tidy, clean. Okay, So now it will arise arise question: can we invert the order of this balance submission? Suppose now you are making a subroutine to get this to evaluate this submission. Since subroutine in any language, you will have a for statement for I equals to 1 to n, whatever the language, do something, and you write an internal loop, and for j equal 1 to n, write something, and the question is, can you exchange these four loops? The answer is yes, because there is no dependence on the upper limits here. Simply, there's much symmetry now. Instead of making all the submissions, fixing the I and making the submission, you can fix J and make the submission. That's all. So let us rewrite this equation after changing the order of the submission. For now, from J equals 1 to N, and from I equals 1 to N capital, we have R dot. Oh, don't forget partial. It's RR. It's partial. The position delta I by partial qj, and I write here delta qj. And I think that there is no problem now since we're making the summation over j, so for each j this one is a constant. So we make all the summation for the I here, and then finally multiply by delta qj. This term will be written as qj. So this is the left hand side. It's the summation from j equal 1 to n. And this qj will turn it like a very nice name. It will be called a generalized force. Now, the force is not related to the particle. It's not like ri. I is an index for each particle. Now, it has an index related to the degree of freedom. So it's called the generalized force. Okay? It's not about the particles, but about the degrees of freedom of the system. Indeed, you can write this equation this way, q1 delta q1, just to try to get some more understanding about what's going on, q1 delta q2, whatever. And these deltas are variations. Don't forget, they are not differentials, they are variations. So this is hand side. So somebody now will ask a question, so what did we do about the dot cancellation? Why did we try to do about the dot cancellation now? Why did we bother ourselves to make effort to get this equation now? We will return to the right hand side and the answer will be clear about the right hand side. The dot cancellation will have a very important role now. So let us go to the right hand side. The right hand side is equal to also this a summation mi ai dot delta ri, but you know, but also a summation for delta ri from j equal 1 to n capital, okay, partial ri by partial qj delta qj. And the summation here is from I equal 1 to n capital. And we do the same step that we have already done with the left hand side. I'll do everything now more or less directly. I will write the double summation. And I will exchange the orders also, because there is nothing that can stop me or nothing that forbids me from doing this. I didn't break any rule in mathematics or algebra. So this is the new one. But please don't forget that this acceleration is the total derivative of the velocity. The product by partial ri by partial qj delta qj. Now we have a little temptation now to do the following. We are tempted to do this. This is the summation from j equal 1 to n. This is the internal summation. I'm sorry, but yes, my handwriting is bad, but I think the ideas are clear. We have the temptation to write this equation one more time in this form. Of course, I forgot the ri here. Ri k dot. So the d by dt is the same. So it comes down, and this bracket is the same. But I will do something I will just include also the partial derivative term inside the total derivative, the total term. Of course, you have the right to object, because this one is not this one. This equation is not this equation. Why? Because if we try to expand this bracket, let us say, and holding this one as a constant, you will get this one. But if you do the second one, and if you hold this one as a constant and get the time derivative of this one, there's something missing here. I will write in red this term. This term is not there. It's not there. It's not there. If it was there, then you could have written what you were looking for. You could have written what? You could have written MI. You could have written this one without any problems. You could have written RI dot d by dt of what? Partial RI by partial QJ. Of course, you have the right to object because it's not there. Yes, that's why I'm writing it in red, in the red color. So the question is what to do now. Just you will subtract this one here. To be subtracted. So you have another solution from j equal 1 to n, from I equal 1 to n, m I. And of course, as I have already told you, we will hold this one as a constant, R dot. Dot. Yes, I'm sorry, I forgot about the dot. And now, I will not write d by dt partial ri by partial qj. I will just write it partial ri dot by partial qj. So there is no trick at all, but just remember that the total derivative, this is the total derivative operator, and the partial derivative operator can be just, the order can be exchanged. There is no problem. You can make the partial derivative and then do the total derivative, or can be the total derivative, and when you do the total derivative, you have a dot, and then do the partial derivative without any problems. So what do we get now? Fine. We are just ahead about a few minutes from the final final goal, but before going through, let me remind you about something very interesting about the kinetic energy. It was equal to half, yes, mi, this I squared. And it was summation, I'm sorry, it was a, yes, you understand, it is summation over all the i's, over all the parts, the total kinetic system, the kinetic energy in your system, okay? So, I'm sorry, I didn't write the summation here. I will write it here. Summation over I, from I equal 1, of course, to n mechanical, half, mi, and I will write bi equal as ri dot, dot, ri dot. Of course, vi squared is equal to vi vector dot vi dot. And now, I think somebody of you will guess what's going on, because there is some similarity between this one, this term, and this term, and this term, and this term. But yes, you have some derivatives here. First of all, what's this? And what's the relation between this one and this one? Let us write the following. Let us write partial t by partial what? You have here what? What do you have here? You have partial qj. So let us write partial t by partial qj. And let us see what we will have. Okay, so you have partial, or sorry, this is the summation still. And let us have the half outside. And let us get mi inside. Of course, the partial derivative will act over this one and this one. So you can write it in this way. You can write the following. You can write partial ri dot by partial qj dot ri dot. So this is the first time, plus, now hold this one as a constant, this should be held as a constant now, ri dot dot partial ri dot by partial qj. And you'll get the idea, you'll get what I'm going to say now, because this term, both terms are symmetric now. Both terms are symmetric. So this can be written as the simple symmetric. We have a 2 here, so this half cancels out. So we will just get the following. We will just get summation and over I from 1 to n mi ri dot partial ri dot by partial qj. So now I'm not sure whether you have got what I'm trying to say, but indeed it's not this term, but it is this term. So we have this term can be written. So let me write it here. This term can be written as summation, and you know the summation is over j, it's not over r. Summation, let me erase this one. Summation over j for what? For partial t by partial qj delta qj. That's very nice. So this is this term. So what about this term? This term can be written, also, but now I will use the red color to add this one here, the dot. Now I have used the dot cancellation. And now, just now you know why did we spend this time just to get this dot cancellation. And just if you have digested this one, you will understand that this term also, I'm using now the blue, can be written as what? Can be written as this, a summation over j from one, of course from one to n, both of them is the same summation units of what? Of d by dt of partial t by partial qj dot. So here we have only qj, but on this one we have just partial qj, and here we have partial qj dot, but both of them, both of this one and this one, is multiplied by this mysterious and important term, delta qj. Delta qj. So now, over now, we can try to conclude what's going on. So the left hand side is equal to sigma qj, the generalized force, delta qj, which is equal to sigma, what it is referring back, d by dt, partial t by partial qj dot, d by dt, of partial t by partial qj dot. Okay, so the whole story, because you have just this is one, yes, you have to subtract also the summation partial t by partial qj minus partial t by partial qj delta qj. So where are we going now? This is summation for all j's. Please don't forget that you can equate the coefficients of each qj from the left to the same coefficient from the right. I mean, you will equate the coefficient of delta q1 with the coefficient from the left with the coefficient of delta q1 also from the right. And it goes with all of them. So you can just write that qj is equal to the summation, without any summation, is equal to d by dt partial t by partial qj dot minus partial t by partial qj. So this Lagrange's equation of motion is not the simplest form. There is another simpler form. This one is termed as Nielsen's form. Nielsen's form. But it's more general than the other form that I will speak about in the next video. The question is that the natural question is why is it possible to equate? The equation was like was written basically in this cell, in this form. Was Q1? Why it is possible to equate the coefficients Q1 delta Q1 plus Qt delta Qt plus equal to some coefficients multiply delta Q1 plus some coefficient multiply delta Qt plus. Why is it possible to equate Q1 to this coefficient and the Q2 to this coefficient? Because these are not, I will remember, because not just, the delta Qs are independent. Delta Q1 and delta Q2 and delta Q3 and whatever, they are independent. There is no relation at all. You cannot say, nobody can come and tell you, fine, if you give me delta Q1, I get delta Q2. No, you cannot. Because they are independent, they are arbitrary. Arbitrary. You cannot deduce one of them from the other, fine. So what? If you say that they are linked by this equation, so if you know Q1 and delta Q1 and Q2 and you can get Q2, then you say that they are not arbitrary, they are related. No, they are not related. They can take any value. So for this equation to be satisfied, while the Q's are independent, that each coefficient of Q1